Hey everybody, this is TJR. And last week when I mentioned that I'd finally picked up the Rolling Stones in mono box set, a lot of people did ask me to review it. And so I've had some time to explore it. And I know a lot has already been said on the internet about this set. I'm sure you've probably already seen a lot of those videos already. But for those of you who may not be familiar and may be asking yourself, well, you know, why mono? Mono was the dominant format in the UK for a lot longer than it was in the US. And like the Beatles, more emphasis was put on the mono mixes during this time period than on the US stereo mixes. But a lot of these mono mixes have been largely lost to time. Not that the recordings didn't exist, but they just weren't being released. And so this set finally allows us to hear these albums in their original mono mixes. So the first question is how do these mixes compare? And also another question that needs to be asked is how do the earlier albums compare to the later albums when you compare them in both their stereo and mono mixes? Now, a while back I did talk about the Beatles in mono box set, which came out back in 2009. One thing that is different from the Beatles in mono versus the Rolling Stones in mono is that the Beatles mono mixes were sometimes subtly and sometimes drastically different from their stereo counterparts. Sometimes effects that were used in the mono mixes would get washed out. Some of the mono mixes feature alternate vocal takes, alternate instrumental tracks, different fade-outs on the endings. There have been huge differences and numerous differences between both the stereo and mono mixes when it comes to the Beatles catalog, but not so, I found, with the Rolling Stones catalog. In fact, on exploration here, I don't really hear anything like that. There's no alternate vocal takes that I can discern, no alternate guitar solos. The arrangements, the recording arrangements, are the same between the stereo and mono mixes. The difference is how they sound in mono versus how they sound in stereo. Now, a lot of what I have heard and read prior to listening to this set is that the songs on the mono mixes overall sound meatier, punchier, more aggressive, and that there's also more clarity. So I began making A to B comparisons. Now, I'm not going to discuss each album in this video, but instead I'm just going to focus on a few selected albums in chronological order and a few individual tracks. So I began with the album Aftermath, which is the fourth British studio album and the sixth American studio album. It's considered by many critics to be a breakthrough album for the band. And I have to say, I have both the stereo version of the UK version of Aftermath, and of course now I have this box set version here, the mono version. And hands down, Aftermath sounds better in mono. Mother's Little Helper sounds deeper, more powerful. You feel more like you're in the room hearing the Stones playing. Stupid Girl sounds more alive and energetic. And there are a few moments during Under My Thumb which sound a bit cooler in stereo, but the song has a lot more swagger in mono. To a certain extent, my reaction to Aftermath reminds me of my reaction to Please Please Me by the Beatles, which was their first album, much beefier and meatier in mono than in stereo. So moving on, the next album that I want to make a comparison with is Between the Buttons. Now, this is the album that was released, I believe, right before the infamous Satanic Majesty's Request album, which I do want to talk about more on a later video, so I'll save that one for later. Now, the track listings on the UK version of Between the Buttons is different from the track listing on the US version. I'm holding the US stereo version here. This is the UK mono version. So for this comparison, I only compared songs that were on both versions. On Between the Buttons, Yesterday's Papers, the opening track on this version here, sounds good in stereo, but feels beefier in mono. And I felt the same way about the next track, My Obsession and Connection. And as I compared chronologically using the mono version, I found that overall, just the mono version did sound better. There might have been a few moments where, hey, that particular track has some cool things going on in stereo, but mostly I found myself leaning towards the mono on this one. Now, the hit singles that were on the US stereo version of this album are not included in the British mono version, and that includes Let's Spend the Night Together. And hearing this album without the singles, I have to admit, made it a different experience. Behind the Buttons is another one of those albums that the Stones have been criticized for trying to sound like the Beatles. And I could definitely sense that when I first listened to it in its stereo configuration. But when you remove those two hit singles, the album has a bit of a different feel. And to me, sounds a lot less like it's trying to imitate the Beatles. And I have to wonder if less critics would have made that charge if the stereo version had had the same track order as its UK mono version. Next, I want to move forward to the album Let It Bleed. And as I listened to it in mono and as I listened to it in stereo, I found that both versions had qualities that were unique to each one that I equally enjoyed about each one. As an example, the song Gimme Shelter. In stereo, it's a little more spacier sounding, a little more moodier sounding, but in mono, it hits harder and packs more of a punch. Another favorite track of mine off this album, Monkey Man, which I feel is as equally moody a track as Gimme Shelter, basically elicited the same reaction when I did an A and B comparison. At the 4 minute and 27 second mark of You Can't Always Get What You Want, I felt that Mick screams. He screams right at that moment, and it feels like as if he's right there in front of me during the mono mix in a way that he's not in the stereo mix. But on the stereo mix, I loved how the organ is just positioned in the mix. I think it's just positioned in a much better way. So both versions of Let It Bleed offer audio pleasures, and they are equally enjoyable in my opinion, but for different reasons. Now, some critics have laid the claim that the differences between these mono mixes and their stereo mixes become less and less as you move further down the timeline in their catalog, and I disagree with this. Street Fighting Man, for instance, off of Beggar's Banquet, which in my opinion has more clarity and just sounds more full in mono. And I also bring up this particular song because there is an extra disc included called Stray Cats that features tracks that weren't officially on any album. The single radio version of Street Fighting Man off of this disc sounds terrible when compared to the version on Beggar's Banquet, mostly because the vocals feel very buried and slightly out of phase. To a certain extent, this radio version or single version of Street Fighting Man reminds me a lot of the radio single version of Penny Lane that was included as one of the many bonus tracks for the recent Sgt. Pepper Super Deluxe Edition. I'm just guessing that the reason for this is because maybe it was created for really tinny sounding transistor radios back in the day. That's all I can figure. Some of the other, you know, major hits that I explored off of this disc included Jumpin' Jack Flash and Honky Tonk Women. And my findings there I thought were interesting. Compared to the stereo version that I have on the 40 Licks Best of Collection to the mono version on this Stray Cats disc here, I found no real significant difference between the stereo and mono versions of Jumpin' Jack Flash. However, on Honky Tonk Woman, I found that the drums felt deeper in mono, but that you get more spatial clarity on the guitars in stereo. Also, mixed vocals felt more in my face in the mono version versus the stereo version. So as you can tell by just this little sampling of songs here, there are sometimes varying degrees of subtlety between them. And at the end of the day, I think a lot of it's going to just depend on your subjective opinion more than anything else. Next, I just want to talk about track duplications. In this set, there are some tracks that get duplicated two times, sometimes even three times. For instance, the US and British mono versions of the album Aftermath feature different track listings, and of course this was common back then. Two tracks from the UK version are not in the US version, but the hit single Painted Black is in the American version and not in the British version. And so as I listened to the duplication of tracks, I realized the songs that are duplicated, like Stupid Girl, Under My Thumb, Lady Jane, these versions are the same on the US version and on the British version. If you listen to Under My Thumb here, it's going to sound exactly the same here. And in fact, Lady Jane, which is off of Aftermath, appears three times in this box set. It appears on both versions of Aftermath, and it appears on the album Flowers, which was an American compilation album. So why do this? Why include so many duplicates? Well, I think it just kind of depends on how you feel about what you grew up with. Many of us in the US grew up with this version of Aftermath, and yet I'm sure people in the UK grew up with this version. And depending on how you like to hear it, that's the one you're going to pull out. But as far as, you know, importing this stuff to your iTunes, let's say you grew up with this version of Aftermath, well then, all you really need to do, unless you need to hear it in this configuration, is take Paint It Black and just add that one track to your iTunes, because otherwise you're duplicating what's already here. And so if you're like me and you don't want a whole lot of duplicate versions of the same song, I'm going to just import this version because I feel this is the version the Stones wanted us to hear. And I'm just going to take Paint It Black and import that one over, even though I grew up with this version. And as far as a track like Lady Jane is concerned, well, I have no sentimentality to hearing it on the album Flowers in its original running order. But if you do, hey, that's great. More power to you. Next, I just want to talk about the packaging. The box, very nice. It's very sturdy. I appreciate that. The printing overall is pretty good. There are some albums where the printing doesn't seem to be as well done on, say, the Beatles in mono box set, where the printing is just outstanding throughout. Some of this might have to do with the fact that there is no access to a lot of the original source material for the album, you know, cover art, and that's why maybe it doesn't look quite as good. Also, I can't help but make Beatles-Stones comparisons at this point. The packaging on the individual albums feels sturdier in the Beatles mono set versus the Stones mono set. Also, on the Beatles mono set, you know, they put the albums in these protective little plastic sleeves here to help protect them. And additionally, as well, inside, along with replicating the actual original, you know, insert sleeves, they put the CDs in these little plastic sleeves to protect them in case they slip out. With the Rolling Stones mono set, unfortunately, they didn't go there. No plastic sleeves, and the discs are just loose like this, and they can slip out easily. I wish they had gone the extra mile for this. It would not have cost them that much more to do that. Now, you actually can buy these little sleeves separately on eBay and also on Amazon. And you can also buy these little sleeves for the CDs themselves as well. You can buy them in bulk. And I do own these. So I actually did try to just simply, you know, put the sleeves on these albums and put them back in the box. What happened, though, is once I put sleeves on all the CDs for the Stones mono set, they wouldn't fit very well in the box, and I found myself kind of having to jam them in there, which is not good. So I just nixed that idea, took off the sleeves. I am going to put these little babies, though, on the CDs inside the inserts, since that won't take up any more room, so I will be doing that, just so that they're a little bit better protected. The way they sit in the box, actually, when you open it up here, the way they sit inside is they are facing downwards, and the CDs can slip out. If you're not careful in how you pull them out, they can slip out and fall down into the box. Like I said, I wish they'd kind of gone there. I wish they'd taken that little extra step. There's also a very nice book featuring lots of great photos and text. I've read some of this, not all of this. I'm still working my way through that. Mostly, I just wanted to talk about the music. And I would say mostly, I am very glad that this set is now available and that I can hear these albums in mono. And as far as, like I said, the earlier albums, it seems to be kind of a hands-down thing. As you get closer to the end, I think there's still plenty to admire about the mono mixes and plenty to enjoy about their stereo mixes too. So at any rate though, that's kind of my overview here on the Rolling Stones in mono, and I'm curious now to hear what you have to say and check out your comments. And I just want to thank everybody for watching. Bye.